I believe you've been there. And here's the reason. 45 years ago, one Sunday night, he touched me. Shackled by a heavy burden. That was me. Neath a load of guilt and shame. Then the hand of Jesus touched me, and now I am no longer the same. You can sing this. He touched me. Oh, he touched me. And oh, the joy that floods my soul. Something happened, and now I know he touched me and made. Since I met this blessed Savior, and since he cleansed and made me whole, I will never cease to praise him. I'm gonna shout it while eternity rolls, because he touched me. Oh, he touched me. And oh, the joy that floods my soul. Something happened, and now I know he touched me and made me whole. He touched me. Oh, he touched me. And oh, the joy that floods my soul. Give the Lord a good clap when you do that. Thank you so much. Thank you. If you put up with me, I'll sing one more, then I'll quit.
That is.
I like the old music and the old songs. I was in a store one day looking for some, and usually you find the old music and they've jabbed them all up. You find the old title, find the old word, and you get them, look at them, and you couldn't even keep up with them. So I picked up about four or five old songs out of the hymn book, and I took them over to the player, and I didn't recognize one of them. The song title and the words were the same, but the music wasn't. So I started to put them back, and laying there by the player was, y'all heard of the Cathedral Quartet, haven't you? I figured you probably had. And there was a song they used to sing laying there, and I thought, there's got to be something wrong with it, because if it's good, they would have bought it. They wouldn't have been this dumb to put it down, but they didn't. So I said, I'm just going to see if it'll play. So I put it in, and it started playing, and nothing wrong with it. And it's really my testimony. I tell people if.
We're not going to go there. But I know the family appreciates each one that's here. And actually, if everyone that has come to the visitation was able to stay, and I know some weren't, this place would not have held everybody. Amen. We got here a little bit before 10, and it was already stretched outside. But appreciate you being here, and I know Mary does, and John, and the rest of the family. Steve said I could say anything I want to. That's dangerous to tell a preacher that. Amen. It was my privilege to be Dave and Mary's pastor for the last few years. We worked side by side. There's three different words that came to my mind that I'd like to share with you before we have the obituary and then also a prayer. But these words came to my mind about Brother Dave Harney. See, Dave was my friend. And it's interesting that just the little while we've been here, people weren't necessarily talking to me, but sometimes you can overhear what people say. And that word was used many times about Dave. Dave was my friend. He was a confidant and a counselor. He would want you to know that he had a friend, and his name is Jesus. He would want you to have Jesus as your friend. Proverbs 18 and verse 24, the last part of that verse says, "There is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother." There's a song, and I'll leave the song singing to Steve, but let me just quote part of a stanza of this song. "What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer." And I want Mary and the family to know this, and I think they do. I know our church family has been much in prayer for the Harney family. And I'm sure perhaps most, if not everyone that's here, has been in prayer for the Harneys. There's another word description of Brother Dave Harney, and that is faithful. Every area of his life has been the hallmark of faithfulness. Whatever area of David's life that you want to examine, you will find faithfulness. 1 Corinthians 4 and verse 2 says this, "Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful." That certainly describes Brother Dave Harney. And I might lapse in some of the words I'll say, but, and I was talking to Steve about this, I like to speak in the present tense and not past tense, because Dave's more alive now than he's ever been. Amen. One thing that we need to realize is that we're just viewing his tabernacle for some 78 years or so. But he has gone on to be with the Lord. The third and last word that came to my mind that describes Dave, and I expect to hear some amens on this one. You've been kind of quiet. But Dave was fervent. You didn't hear me, so let me say that again. Dave was fervent. The Bible says in Romans chapter 12, and it's an admonition for all of us that belong to the Lord, and it's certainly an attribute that Dave exhibited, and I think we need to, and it says, "Fervent in spirit, serving the Lord." Whatever Dave did, he put his whole heart into it with fervency. Can I hear an amen? I mean, it was just a joy when Dave would sing. Amen. After he had his heart attack, after he recovered and so forth, I don't think anyone would have ever guessed that he had a heart ailment. Huh? Because he was fervent in spirit. Colossians 3, verse 23 says this, "And whatsoever ye do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not unto men." There's probably a lot of other words that could describe my brother and my friend, Dave Harney, but I just wanted to share those three with you. On April the 30th, 1943, in Cynthiana, Kentucky, David was born to Stanley and Josephine Harney. To hear him tell it, he had a hand in it. Dave would always say, quote, "I was supposed to be an April Fool's baby, but I fooled them all and came at the end of the month," end of quote. Now, that's Dave. This began the life of a man who never met a stranger, always had a joke in his pocket, but never backed down from a serious moment. In the early 60s, Dave met Mary Adamson and was immediately smitten. On December the 4th, 1965, that union would be finalized, and the duo that we would all know for 55 plus years as Dave and Mary had begun. Not keen on farm life, David and Mary moved to Dayton, Ohio after being married. Dave had been in the military, but now had taken a job with the Jewel T Company as a salesman. In 1966, Andy and Jolene Hill, friends of Dave and Mary, would invite them to pack a pew at Faith Baptist Church. Let me just pause here and say I want to thank the pastor here and the leadership and the church family that's invited Dave to come back one more time. Amen. Serving the Lord here, I think 40 plus years perhaps. That night, they heard Charles Lynn talk about a need for a Savior. On that first evening, Mary would sense that need for Jesus, but walk away only with conviction. However, as they talked at home and were visited by Brother Lynn, Dave would become convinced that this was the best path for their life. And just weeks after that initial visit to faith, they would both give their hearts, lives, and all to Christ. It didn't take long for Dave to jump in to serve. He started out with Dr. Jack Henry and the teenagers of Faith Baptist Church. Soon, Dr. Henry would be sent away on military orders, leaving Dave at the helm. Not long after that, Pastor Lynn would ask Dave if he would help out with the music and choir at Faith Baptist. Famously, Charles, as Brother Lynn, told Dave, quote, "If you could just help out in the meantime until we find someone else, that would be great," end of quote. Apparently, they never found someone because 40 years later, Dave retired from Faith Baptist. He was still doing it. Upon retirement, Dave forgot to retire. He spent the next 16 and a half years traveling, singing, and encouraging people all over through the Dave Harney Ministries. During that time, Dave recorded 7 albums and 2 DVDs worth of Southern gospel music. He also sang and preached at multiple churches in Ohio, Kentucky, Indiana, West Virginia, Virginia, Florida, Oklahoma, and Kansas. He loved to travel and encourage pastors to do what Brother Lynn had taught him years before, quote, "Keep on keeping on," end of quote. Dave lived a life of service, serving us all in many different ways. He helped raise some of you. He taught many to sing. He encouraged many to follow Jesus, some vocationally, but all passionately. For many, he came to hospital rooms, prayed, encouraged, and somehow got you to smile in the midst of dire circumstances of your life. He has sung and spoke at many funerals, weddings, concerts, services. Some of you named children after him, and some of you are named in honor of him. Dave was preceded in death by his father, Stanley David, and mother, Josephine Sipe, as well as 2 brothers, A.G. and Elmer Allen Harney. He is survived by his wife, Mary, son, John, and daughter-in-law, Angel, his two grandsons that he loved dearly, Spencer and Zach, his sisters, Maxine, Brenda, and Ruth, brothers, Charlie, and Steve. You know, I've not met you, but if you're brother or sister, would you just raise your hand? Huh? All right. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for sharing, Dave, with all of us. And though we mourn today the loss of someone so instrumental to all our lives, I believe that Dave would quote the Apostle John to tell you how he feels. This is the quote. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. So walk in truth and love and continue the legacy of a man who loved God more than he loved any of us. Now I'm going to ask perhaps if you can, and you might not be able to, but just in reverence to the Lord and respect to our brother Dave Harney, would you stand, and I'm going to have a word of prayer. Could you stand, please? And we're not saying goodbye. We're saying so long for now. Amen. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Heavenly Father, as we approach the throne of grace, I want to thank you, first of all, that we have that privilege to pray. Let us ever be reminded that it is a blood-bought privilege. And Lord, I want to thank you for touching Dave Harney at one time in his life, and he saw his need of salvation in Christ, and he came in faith believing. Lord, I want to thank you for the way you have used him throughout all of these years. And Lord, I ask especially that you would be with Mary and John and Angel and the rest of the family and other family members and friends and loved ones. And Lord, we call on the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, that can comfort only as he can during a time such as this. And Lord, my prayer would go beyond comfort today, and I would implore that if there's those here that do not know Christ as personal Savior, this would be the hour, the day, and the time that the Holy Spirit would bring conviction in their life, and they would hear, believe, and be saved. For it is in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you. You may be.
Dreamed of a city called glory, so bright and so fair. As I entered the gates, I cried, holy, angels all knew me there. They carried me from mansion to mansion. Then I said, I want to see Jesus. He's the one who died for all. I said, Timothy, I want to see Jesus, 'cause he's the one who died for me. I bowed on my knees and cried, the Son of God. Well, I sing glory to the Son of God.
I get the honor today to lead this celebration of life. I am not preaching my brother's funeral. He preached it himself. And I could not elaborate, expound, or improve on anything that he's done. So today I'm just going to fill in a few little spots along the way as I talk about my big brother. You've already heard the beginning of the obituary, how on April 30th, 1943, Dave Harney came into this world, and nothing has been the same since. There's a reason why us three brothers live in three different states. Because no one could handle all three of us at the same time. He was born to tenement farmers. Mom and Dad never had a whole lot. We never had a whole lot. I hear people say all the time, we were poor, but we didn't know it. We were poor, and we knew it. Didn't want anything we could do about it. When you get the same Christmas gift 6 years in a row, you know you're poor. At least that's what Dave would say. But from such humble beginnings, we gather here this morning to remember a man who has touched all of our lives. Some of us he led to the Lord. Some of us he encouraged to serve the Lord. Some of us he threatened to send to the Lord. And I believe John and I are at the top of that list. Me probably more so than him. From the fifth child of tenement farmers to a preacher of the gospel of Jesus Christ, how in the world does all that happen? And that's the path I'd like to take you down today. Psalm 37:23 says this, "The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. He delighteth in his way." As you just heard a few moments ago, in 1966, Dave and Mary, at the invitation of friends, came here to Faith Baptist Church. They needed help in their lives. They needed help in their marriage. They thought they were coming to fulfill a favor. What they didn't know was this verse, "The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord." God had a plan for Dave and Mary Harney. They didn't know it. None of us knew it. But God did. It started with the two of them coming to know Jesus Christ as their Savior right over there in that old building. They both trusted Christ and invited him into their lives. If only they could have known then what all was going to happen in the future. But God doesn't work that way. He works in steps, and that was the first step. The next step was about to happen. Brother Charles Lynn, the pastor here at the time, asked him to help out in the youth department. Dave said, "I don't know anything about working in a youth department." He said, "That's okay. The teenagers don't know anything about you working in the youth department either, so you all get along fine." They had no idea what was about to take place, but God did. You see, when you start serving, you start learning, and then you start growing, and that's exactly what began to happen. Because in 1967, there would be another step. Colonel Jack Henry was the youth director, and he would be transferred to another Air Force base, and there would be need for someone to take his place. And there was Dave and Mary Harney taking another step. The next step came in early 1970, as you have heard, when at the request of Brother Lynn, once again, Dave was asked to lead the singing and direct the choir here at Faith Baptist Church. Something you all need to know about us Baptist preachers. When we find somebody and put them in a spot, you got to quit or die to get out of it. Because we ain't removing you. In November of 1970, he was asked to take another step. Dave was asked to start working at the church. He used to joke that the church told him they were going to pay him weekly, and he thought that meant every 7 days. Until he received his first paycheck and realized it meant W-E-A-K-L-Y. But that didn't stop Dave Harney, because he wasn't in this for the money. If you were ever in his youth department, there's a couple of things that you will recognize instantly. If he had you singing, and I learned how to sing right up here on this stage. If he had you singing, he expected you to sing loud. He expected your mouth to be wide open, and three fingers ought to be able to fit inside. And there were a few times he stuck three of those fingers in my mouth, and we'll just leave it at that. If you ever received a visit from him, you just might have played a game of basketball with a man in a suit and a tie and dress shoes. That was Dave Harney. But is it any surprise? The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his ways. Not only was God delighted to see what Dave was doing, but Dave delighted in doing it too. He drove it into our heads that we could do all things through Christ which strengtheneth us. He wanted us to do something and do it with everything that we possibly had. Do something for God, and God would bless it. Dave Harney was Mr. Consistent. If you saw him in 1970 and then never saw him again until 1990, nothing changed. And if you didn't see him again until 2020, nothing changed. He still wanted you to do something for the Lord. He still had on a suit and tie, and he still parted his hair on the side. Now, in the 60s, there was a little bit of a flat top, and in the early 2000s, the part just began traveling farther and farther down. And that porch. If you were ever caught out in the rain, you could get underneath that and survive for a while. That's why he never carried an umbrella. And every once in a while, especially at camp or on youth activities, he'd wear that goofy hat and that Jive Turkey t-shirt. As a matter of fact, he wore that Jive Turkey t-shirt every day of camp, every year at camp for over 20 years. I am convinced he would go home at the end of camp, just stow it in the corner, and it would stand there waiting on him till next year. But none of us would have been surprised if he'd have shown up to play softball in a suit and tie. It was just natural. He was always happy, always delighting in what he was doing, and we who were around him were always encouraged to do the same thing and to tell people about Jesus Christ. Dave Harney was Mr. Consistent. Psalm 37:24 goes on to say, though he fall, he shall not utterly be cast down, for the Lord upholdeth him with his hand. There were times when Dave got down. In the early days, before John, there were a couple of miscarriages. I can remember our dad and mom talking quietly, and I knew something was up, but they weren't going to tell me anything about it. But the Lord upheld them. In the early 70s, Dave had to have surgery on his vocal cords. There was a concern that he might not be able to sing again, but the Lord upheld him. There were some teens along the way that lost their lives, took their lives, or wasted their lives. I can remember him talking about them, weeping over them, and praying for their families, but the Lord upheld him. When our father passed away in 1992, Dave took it hard, but the Lord upheld him. In 1994, when Brother Lynn passed away, I remember talking with Dave about it. The tears welled up in his eyes, and he said, I don't know why God had to take him now, but I will trust him. But Stevie, I sure do miss him. And again, the Lord upheld him. When our mom passed away of cancer in 1996, again, the Lord upheld him. No matter how many things came his way, he was still consistent, steadfast in serving the Lord, and in keeping Christ first, doing what he had always done, telling people about Jesus Christ and the difference he can make in their lives. In 2005 came the next step. Dave retired from Faith Baptist and started Dave Harney Ministries. There were those who said it couldn't be done and some who said it shouldn't be done. But if you haven't learned by now, there are two ways to motivate a Harney. Tell us it can't be done or tell us we can't do it. And we will find a way every time. I don't know how many churches he and Mary have ministered in, how many choirs he has helped with, pastors he has encouraged, and people he has inspired. I do know that it reaches far beyond those simple beginnings in the foothills of Kentucky, or with just some kids instead of a youth group at Faith Baptist Church. The messages to my computer the past couple of weeks have been endless. From Papua New Guinea, I heard this. Good morning, my brother. It's sad to hear about your brother Dave passed on. He impacted my life when I was studying at Marietta Bible College in Ohio. He inspired my life so much, and I thank God for him and his wife. I pray for God to give peace and comfort in time like this. We will see him in eternity. Came from Silas Stephen Olap, missionary and church planter in the mountains of Papua New Guinea. I received another message. We are extending our condolences to the whole family. Brother David is one of my favorite gospel singers and preachers. God's comfort and grace to you all. Joey Cosme, Bulacan, Philippines. And then I got this one. The first memory I have of Brother Dave as he was when he came to my church in Logan, Ohio to sing and preach. He told me that he had a brother who traveled all over the states and preached to kids. I knew who Brother Steve was, but Brother Dave was the one to tell me that Steve took interns with him in the summertime. It was Brother Dave who gave me the idea to ask Brother Steve to travel with him as an intern that next summer. Long story made short, I traveled and worked with Brother Steve for 8 years, and now I'm in Taiwan using what I learned. Brother Dave had a big part in making all that happen. My prayers to all the family. Adam and Ashley Walls, missionaries to Kaohsiung, Taiwan. I also received a copy of an actual letter that was sent to Dave back in 2002. The letter said, "Dave, you know you're special when I write a letter. I think in my entire life I have written a total of 2 or 3 that I can remember, but I felt this one had to be written. For some reason, you've been on my mind a lot lately. If you haven't looked at the bottom of the letter yet, it's your old friend Ken the Kentuckian. Seriously, when you move away, you really get a chance to see how many things, and in this case, people, that you take for granted. I don't want this to be too mushy a letter, but I sincerely wanted to thank you for, I guess, just being you. Angie and I can't express how much Mary and your ministry has impacted our lives. We both can't really put into words what a joy it was to be part of the home builders class. To add to that, you will never realize how refreshing it was to sit under your plain-spoken teaching of God's Word. I know when I first started attending Faith, I had no concept of serving the Lord through outreach, but I can sincerely say that your example made Christian service seem real and necessary." He concluded this message to me by saying this, "Steve, I just wanted you to know how much we loved your brother and the eternal impact he has had on our family. Signed, Ken Kelly." And then I received this story in a roundabout way. A couple had responded to a Facebook post that I had made who were trained in our ministry. And then someone responded to them who knew them through another ministry. And it said, "Dave was my youth pastor when I came to Christ late in high school. My first memory of him before I ever came to church or Jesus was him playing basketball with his teenagers while wearing dress slacks, a white t-shirt, and tennis shoes, but still running circles around us all. I can't even begin to express the impact he had on my life. He was the first pastor I ever knew, and he set the bar high with his love for Jesus and us kids who needed a godly example." That was from Andrew Tate, pastor of Friendship Baptist Church in Lugoff, South Carolina. I know I could keep going. If I were to ask each of you today sitting here, you have a story that you could tell of how this man impacted your life as well and inspired or changed your life. There are those in life who get the acclaim. They are the Moseses, the Peters, the John the Baptist, the Joshuas, the Josephs, the Pauls, and even the Judases. But occasionally there is one who comes along. He doesn't try to make a name for himself. He's just there doing what God called him to do. He's a Bezalel. Who, you might ask, is Bezalel? In Exodus 31, verses 2 through 5, the Bible says, "See, I have called by name Bezalel, the son of Uri, the son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah, and I have filled him with the Spirit of God in wisdom and understanding and in knowledge, and in all manner of workmanship, to devise cunning works, to work in gold and in silver and in brass and in cutting of stones, to set them and in carving of timber, to work in all manner of workmanship." Without Bezalel, there would have been no tabernacle. He was the one God had called him. God had placed in him the ability to know how to take all those crazy instructions that God had given Moses make them work to become a tabernacle. That was Dave Harney. He knew how to make it all work. He knew how to encourage each of us. He knew how to inspire each of us. He knew what it would take to get a bunch of teenagers strung out on hormones and each other and point us in a direction that could change the world. He never went to college. He didn't have any degrees. He's never been the big name that everybody wanted to be like, but I truly believe that he was the most gifted, honest, loyal, devoted, and dedicated man for the job at hand that I've ever met in my life, and especially in my 45 years of ministry. Dave Harney never leaned to the right or to the left. He was always the same, always encouraging others to serve the Lord, always looking for someone to tell about Jesus. He was a Bezalel, and just as Bezalel, God called him by name to do what he did from 1966 until October 11th, 2021. Dave Harney was a man of God, filled with the Spirit of God, who loved God, served God, preached God, told others about God, and urged you to do the same. He was a man called by God. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. And so that brings us to the last step, the one none of us wanted at this time, but the ultimate step for God. At about 6:20 p.m. on October 11th, God said, "Dave, time for one more step." And Dave said, "Yes, Lord." And as he struggled to take his last earthly breath, he freely inhaled his first celestial breath in the presence of the one who he had spent over 50 years telling people about. Psalm 116:15 says, "Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints." I used to wonder about that verse. That is until 1999 when our oldest son went off to college. I'm telling you, I don't think I ever had anything in my life that hurt so much as driving away from Springfield, Missouri and leaving him behind. The house was empty. It seemed lonely. I told people, "Remember how I told you love your kids unconditionally? Well, I'm changing my mind. Hate them. It's a whole lot easier when they leave home then." Every time he was going to come home, it was a party at our house. Every time Cheryl cooked his favorite foods, we cleaned, we got stuff ready. We couldn't wait. We would stand at the door and watch for him to arrive. And sometimes that took a long time because our son doesn't do things like most people do. He does it at his own pace. He does things at his own pace so much they had to induce labor and it still took 24 hours. But it was a party when he came home. Well, for all of Dave's life, God has been waiting. His child had lived down here, struggling, going through the pains of this life, and giving his best. And there's no doubt that God had blessed Dave and Mary. No doubt about that at all. But on October 11th, God said, "It's time. Time for one of my children to come home. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints." One of his children coming home, the rejoicing, the thrill, the joy, the overwhelming reception, and those words, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." It all took place that night. What a last step. Now, I can't completely prove this next statement, but I have some pretty strong circumstantial evidence that I believe leans in my favor. In Acts chapter 7 and verse 56, as Stephen, the first martyr, is about to die, Stephen looks up toward heaven and he says, "Behold, I see heavens opened and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." Now, if you're a student of the Scriptures, any at all, you know that throughout the New Testament, Scripture tells us that Jesus is seated at the right hand of God. When Stephen was about to be stoned to death, Jesus stood up. I submit to you that he stood up and began to applaud the entrance of a faithful servant to the portals of heaven and welcome him home. I believe he does that for every faithful servant who takes their last breath here and their first breath there. And with that evidence at hand, I believe that Jesus on October the 11th at 6:20 p.m. stood up once again and said, "Welcome home, Brother Dave. Thou good and faithful servant, I'm glad you are here. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints." But we're still here. And only the living regret the leaving. Only the ones left behind will cry. Only the living know shadows of grieving. For there's joy on the other side. Mary, John, Angel, Spencer, Zach, family. I know it's going to be hard. But I can assure you this, and this verse applies to me now. Psalm 37:25 says, "I have been young, and now am old. Yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread." I know times are going to get rough. The memories at times will be overwhelming. But this isn't goodbye. This is just so long. And for those of us who know Jesus, we will see Dave again soon. And God is going to take care of us, be there for us, and uphold us with his hand, and sometimes hug us up close in his arms, as a father does. What is this life? It's a vapor that appeareth for a short time and then vanishes away. It doesn't last long. And someday we will once again see Dave, know him, and rejoice with him. And to use the words of his son John as he closed out that obituary, though we mourn today the loss of someone so instrumental to all our lives, I believe that Dave would quote the Apostle John to tell you how he feels. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. So walk in truth and love and continue the legacy of a man who truly, truly loved God more than he loved any of us. If you're here today and you don't know Christ as your Savior, Dave would want me to tell you about what he found over 50 years ago. The love, the joy, the peace that comes from knowing Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. You can have all that too. You don't have to be a Baptist. You don't have to go to church. You don't have to be baptized. None of that stuff's going to get you to heaven. You can't even be good enough to get into heaven. You have to ask Jesus Christ into your life and ask him to forgive you of your sins, to save you and to give you a home in heaven forever with him. If you haven't done that and would like to, all you have to do is ask him. Romans 10:13 says, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You can ask him today right there where you are. If you'd like to be saved, to start that relationship that Jesus and Dave had together for over 50 years, then you can do that today. And if you're here today and you find yourself having strayed away from God, I don't care how far you think you've gone, just turn around and take a look. You'll find he's just one step away. 1 John 1:9 says, "If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." You're just a step away from the cleansing, from that joy, that purpose for your life once again. Won't you reach out to him today? He's waiting with open arms, waiting for you to come to him and let him give you rest. There's room at the cross for all of us today, and especially you. There's room at the cross for you if you'll just take that step. Dave Harney, Mr. Consistent, husband, father, grandfather, brother, youth director, choir director, preacher, evangelist, singer, and best friend anyone in the world could ever have, is gone. But if I may borrow the words of Billy Graham, who actually borrowed them from D.L. Moody, who probably borrowed them from somebody else, and if you will allow me to change them just a little, I believe if I could stand Dave up here today, this is what he would tell you right now. You're here today because you read or heard that Dave Harney is dead. Don't you believe a word of it. For I am more alive than I've ever been before. I've just changed my address. For I've moved into the presence of God, and in his presence there is fullness of joy and life evermore. Won't you come join me? Father, thank you for the time we've had here today in remembering a man who has impacted all of our lives so dearly, whether as my family, my friend, as a youth director, a choir director, a mentor, a father, a grandfather. He has touched each of us dearly. He will not soon be forgotten. But now he's in your presence. God, I pray that you would supply that grace that you said would be sufficient, a double dose of that grace to Mary. Wrap your arms around her and let her feel your presence today. Be with John and Angel and the boys. Encourage them. In the days ahead, it's going to get rough. But you're still God. You're still on the throne, and you're still in control. And we can trust you. Father, I pray if there's someone here today that does not know you as their personal Savior, that today would be the day that they would come to that saving knowledge. We will thank you and praise you for all that you have done and are going to do in Jesus' name. Now, with your heads bowed and your eyes closed, if you're here today and you've never trusted Christ as your personal Savior, today would be a real good day to do that. I know it's a funeral service, a celebration of life service, a remembering of Dave Harney service. What a day it would be for you if today was the day that you remembered. I put my faith and my trust in Jesus Christ. And if you're sitting there today, and that's you, the Bible says simply, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Would you just pray and ask him today? Just say, dear Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. Come into my life. Forgive me of my sins. Save me. Give me a home in heaven. And use me in your will. If you prayed that prayer today, heads are bowed, eyes are closed, no one's peeking, nobody's looking around, I'm not going to embarrass anybody, but if you prayed that prayer today and you really meant it, would you just slip your hand up? I want to keep praying for you. Anyone like that at all today? Christian, if you're here today and you've gotten away from God, right there in the moment, just bow your head and say, God, forgive me. I want to get back into your presence. Matthew 11:28. He says, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He's waiting for you to whisper his name today. He's only a prayer away. And he'll reach out and touch your life once again and bring you back into the fold if you'll just ask him. No matter who you are today, there's room at the cross for you if you'll reach out to Jesus. You will find he's always been reaching out to you. Father, thank you for the life of a man well lived. Help us to go forth in the legacy that he's left. And we'll praise you for it all in Jesus' name. If you'll remain seated for just a moment, here's a song. And then, people from the field will come and dismiss you. We'll go down to the back. You can go with us to the cemetery. The family will have some time down front. We would ask that you just wait outside.
Silver.
measure.